Welcome to the monthly market report. I'm excited to be back with you. It's February 2021, and we are ready to talk about everything happening in the housing market. So I'll jump right in. We've got a lot to cover over the next 20 or so, 25 minutes. And let's start with where we sit right now coming out of last year. I'll share this the screen here in my slides. It's a quote from NAR that really kind of summarizes 2020. With the final numbers coming out, existing home sales totaled 5.64 million in 2020, up 5.6% from 2019, and the most since before the Great Recession. So for everybody out there that's been following everything that we've talked about in this area, we said there's going to be more business on the other side of the lockdown than folks that are out there can handle, and that certainly proved out to be true. We sold more homes last year than we did in 2019. And the amazing thing is, as experts look forward, we're projected to sell even more in the coming year. And they agree to that. And here are the transaction forecasts from Fannie, from NAR, and from MBA, each one of them having more sales this year than we had last year during the pandemic. And I filtered a few out of here that don't include new homes or only existing homes, whatever the case may be, but they agree as well and say, we're gonna sell more homes. Now, what's the story here? The 2020 market is really setting up the 2021 market. A lot of things that we're going to talk about in just a minute, where listing is going to come from, all those things are going to begin to come into play in the real estate market. But if we continue this journey about what experts are saying right now, we have the most up-to-date home price forecaster. And you can see this one here, covering really a scale of anything from NAR down to CoreLogic and everywhere in between. The average of these seven forecasters is about 5%. Remember, historically in this country, home price appreciation has been about 3.8%. So seeing that above the historical appreciation number, what does that mean? Well, price will always be a factor of supply and demand. We've talked about that extensively. And even as we look at what CoreLogic just said about the 2020 market, is that home prices increased 9.2%. Quite a hefty increase due to what? Limited supply and more people saying we need a home. And so as you look at these home price forecasts right now, we can say, okay, there's going to be more supply coming into the market. And there's going to certainly be more demand. And these experts know that. And they're saying, we're going to see healthy appreciation in this real estate market. Interest rates are something certainly that all of us are wondering about and talking about. And this is the latest look of projections from Freddie Mac on the 30-year fixed. And as we've talked about before, the orange there shows where we've been, blue showing where we're going. And what's different this time? Well, it used to be flat. We're going to stay in kind of this flat environment, and we're starting to see that be revised up. And I would expect as we go through the year, maybe seeing it revised up even more as the economy starts to improve. But the reality right now is that we are forecasting, and by looking at experts, that we're going to be in a good rate environment in 2021, certainly in the low threes, whether that's 3.2%, 3.5%, or whatever forecasters may say throughout the year. Historically speaking, as we can see here, in a very advantageous interest rate market going forth this year. And that's going to cause more people to say, now is the time. But certainly there are those of us, even in our industry, that think, rates are going to rise and that's going to squelch demand. No doubt affordability will be, eaten into as rates rise and as prices rise in houses. And I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. But Mark Fleming said this, and I thought it was very, very interesting. He said, rising interest rates reduce house buying power and affordability. We know that, but here's the key, but are often a sign of a strong economy, which increases home buyer demand. By any historic standard, today's mortgage rates remain historically low and will continue to boost house buying power and keep purchase demand robust. So it's natural to think we're starting to rise in rates and can expect that in the in the coming months. And that may, you know, we may say we're going to sell less homes than that. But historically speaking, a rising rate environment is signaling a better and improving economy. The gift of a recession or the gift of an economic slowdown is that we see, the Fed working and the federal government working to help lower home loan rates by the levers they have to help spur the economy forward. That's what they're doing. They know the economy will not recover until housing recovers. And we're the beneficiaries of that. You know, if we look at what experts are saying, this is the latest rate projections going all the way through the first quarter of 2022. And you can see there's a range there, 3.1 on the low side, 3.5% on the high side, but all together showing this environment that I believe is going to be a very, very good rate environment. The one thing that, you know, I think we want to talk about with any client that we're working with is that, you know, the reality of this year as it goes along is it's just going to cost a little bit more. So if they're thinking about doing something, now is the time. Now is the time to go ahead and, you know, transact, buy, sell, whatever you're going to do, because the environment's going to be much more favorable at this point in the year. As we go along, it'll get more expensive. But, there's no doubt folks are saying, hey, I would put my home on the market, but we don't know where we're going to go. So I want to address that question this way of where will all the listings come from? You know, we are in a situation right now, historically low inventory in this country, and we need more listings. We need more people to put their home for sale. It could be the one thing that certainly holds back the market and probably has held back the market relative to the number of people that want to purchase a home, just simply can't because they can't find one, or, you know, somebody doesn't put their home on the market because they don't know where they were going to go. So let's talk about this for just a couple of minutes. I want to give you some good visuals to help articulate where we see that coming from an expert's perspective. First of all, Allie Wolf here, chief economist at Zondo. You know, we use Allie a lot, a trusted source for information. She says this: some people will feel comfortable listing their home in the first half of 2021. So as we get into this year and people are more optimistic with regard to, you know, vaccines, things that are improving, they're going to feel comfortable listing. Others, she says, will want to wait until the vaccines are widely distributed. This suggests more inventory will be for sale in late 2021 and into the spring selling season of 2022. So what are experts saying right now? More inventory is going to come back to market as people feel more comfortable. Doesn't mean it's not going to happen on the front end of this year. She says some people will feel comfortable listing on the front half of this year, probably more in the second half of the year. And then even going into the spring of next year, we'll see even more feel comfortable for that. So that's where those numbers come from, is forecasters say, you know, we're going to sell 5% more homes this year than we did, you know, in the prior year. And in last year, we sold more than the year before. But let's look real quick at where we sit right now. This is a look at month's supply of inventory going all the way back to September 2019, a little over a year there. And, you know, as of December, 1.9 months of active inventory across the country. Now, to put this into perspective, last December, we had 3.6 months of inventory across the country. Even then, we were back in a market that was, you know, inventory deprived. We had an inventory challenge, and even more of an inventory challenge where we sit today due to all of the things that we know happened in 2020. And really what I don't want to miss here about 2020 is 2020 redefined home for a lot of people. Certainly low interest rates drove demand. There's no doubt about that. But a lot of people said we need something different in a home. The needs that we have for our family, for us individually, whatever the case may be, have changed. And now we need to go out and we need to downsize. We need to move up. We need to do whatever we need to do for the needs that we have. And no doubt we're seeing low inventory in the market because of that. NAR says this: total housing inventory at the end of December totaled 1.07 million units, down 6.4% from November and down 23% from a year ago, what we talked about, 1.39 million units. Unsold inventory sits at an all-time low of 1.9 months supply at the current sales pace, down 2.3 months in November and down from the three-month figure recorded in December 2019. NAR first began tracking this in 1982. So what are they saying? Going all the way back to 1982, we're at the lowest point that we've tracked active inventory. To put real numbers to this, there are about 320,000 less homes on the market today than there were this time a year ago. Okay, so remember that number 320,000, because I'm going to come back to it with regard to housing. There's also experts in the industry that agree, you know, homes are coming to market as quick as they, I mean, homes are being sold as quick as they come to market. So really the health of the market, it's going to depend on how quickly homes come into the market, maybe not this resting inventory number. So something we'll want to watch and pay attention to. So what are the things that are going to influence people to put their homes on the market? We talked about, you know, people are going to feel comfortable. The next piece is working from home. This is a very interesting study that came out from NAR's Real Estate Forecast Summit. 2019, about 6% of the population working from home. 2020, that shoots up to 21%. 2021, we're estimating about 18% of people working from home. And 2022, settling into about 12%. What do I take away from that? The difference between 2019 and 2022, about double the number of people working from home. There are people that this year will get clarity on what that means for them. That may mean in some cases, I don't have to go back to the office. I don't think that's what everybody's gonna be doing. In some cases, I only need to be in a day or two a week or some hybrid type schedule. At that point, maybe I don't have to live where I have lived, you know, so I shorten my commute because I've got to go in 5 days a week. But maybe, you know, where I live in Richmond, Virginia, a lot of people live here and commute to DC. If they only have to be in, you know, once a week, they can do it much more cheaply. And there are a lot of places in this country that people will make that same type of decision or may move, you know, altogether to a different area because they don't have to be where they were before. The other area that's going to bring more inventory into the market is building. Joel Kahn here from MBA says this, new home sales activity, both mortgage applications and home sales, ran at a pace considerably ahead of 2019, showing the ongoing strong growth in housing demand and new residential construction. So, you know, we ended the year at, you know, builder optimism, builder confidence at a high. We ended the year at starts at a high, permits at a high. That inventory is coming. You know, we talked before last year about the analogy of housing inventory was like toilet paper. You know, the storekeeper couldn't get enough on the shelf before it got purchased. And same with housing. We can't bring a listing to market faster than it gets purchased. Well, if we use the same store analogy, there's some trucks that are going to back up to the store that are going to make people more comfortable. The builder truck's going to back up throughout the year and bring more inventory into the market. The comfortability and safety truck's going to back up. You know, we said people will feel more safe, putting their homes on the market. Those that didn't put their homes on the market, you know, said, hey, we thought about doing something, we didn't do it. They're going to feel better. You know, I want to remind you of this. We've talked about it before, but a good reminder of the reasons that people have not put their home on the market in the last year. 31% financial uncertainty, saying we don't know what's going to happen, so we're going to hold off right now. 34%, life is just too uncertain. 25%, you know, we have concerns about COVID, of bringing people in our home or going out and look, whatever the case may be. A lot of those concerns, you can expect for people to get a little bit more clarity, hopefully a little bit more comfort and safety in that. As we move through all the things that are happening to improve the situation relative to the pandemic. So I think these trucks are going to, you know, back up to the store if that's the analogy we want to use. I think there's another place I always want to stay on top of for you is the forbearance question. It's a big question about, you know, what's going on with these people that are coming out of forbearance. This is coming from the MBA. It's the most recent information from June 1st to January 21st of this year, so just a few days old. And this is what's happening from people that are coming out of forbearance. Now, we're going to stay on top of this and bring you the most up-to-date information on that, but I want to cover this with you, and then I want to talk about what it's going to mean to our market. First of all, about 2.7 million people in active forbearance right now. Those that have come off, this is what's happened. 51.7% are in that green portion of the pie. That means they've made their monthly payments. They either paid off their loan through a refinance or sold the home or paid it off. Past due payments who are brought current. These are all the people that didn't need it, I'm going to say. I'm not saying they took it incorrectly, but maybe this is a small business owner saying, I don't know what tomorrow is going to bring for my business, so I'm going to take forbearance as an insurance policy in case, you know, something were to happen where I couldn't make my mortgage payments. Half of them, one out of two, didn't need it, okay? So I think keeping that in mind, because the way this conversation started was everybody's going to go into forbearance, everybody's going to go into, into foreclosure after that. It's simply not playing out that way. 33%, one third, are in some sort of workout or repayment plan. This is a loan modification. This is a loan deferral. We're going to attack the missing payments or the makeup payments on the back end of the loan. We're going to do a rate and term, refi, whatever the case may be. One out of three, significant portion of folks in this category, the bank saying, hey, how do we work with you? Okay, 15.3% right now are still in trouble. These are people that don't have a loss mitigation plan or are now delinquent. These are ones that have already started, a short sale, some type of distress sale, deed in lieu, all of those things. Those are the ones that could turn into a foreclosure at some point. I don't think they're all going to turn into that, but they could. Those are the ones that are at risk. Now, I think don't hear me say that there's, don't take away from this, there's not an issue with forbearance. I think we still need to talk about this. There are still people that are going to come off of forbearance that are going to need to do something, okay? And I'm going to talk just a minute about that related to the sale and foreclosures and things like that. Will forbearance bring a rise in foreclosures? Sure, it will. We don't see a crisis. We've been very, very vocal about that from a data perspective and still don't see a crisis. But will we see a rise in foreclosures? Yeah, we will. Can you expect to see headlines that say foreclosures doubled, foreclosures tripled in this country? Certainly, you could expect that. And I think we will see that. But more than anything, this is our opportunity to help people that we're doing business with. To say, hey, do you need somebody to talk about this? Are you coming off of forbearance and need to have a private conversation about how much do you owe in your house? What is your house worth? What are your options? So that hopefully if somebody needs to do something, they can sell their home, put a little money in their pocket, pay a commission, do everything they need to do, and then move on and provide for their family and get to the other side of the financial crisis they're in. We've talked a lot about the equity in homes. I want to bring this quote from Lawrence Yoon because I think there's still a question about equity, but it's this. Given the huge price gains recently, I don't think many homes will have to go into foreclosure. I think homes will be just sold and there will be cash left over for the seller, even in a distressed situation. So that's a bit of a silver lining in that we don't expect a massive sale of distressed properties. So, with the state right now of equity, and we've talked extensively about this, if you've been following the monthly market report and the average equity in folks that are in forbearance, the average equity in a home, we know equity is strong today. Giving people options they didn't have back in the housing crisis. Very, very different. In the housing crash, folks were underwater. They literally owed more on the home than they, than it was worth, and they walked. We're in a very, very different situation today. And it's important that we as an industry and as individuals are vocal about that so that if people are experiencing this, they understand what their options are and we can help them with that. The next topic I want to talk about for just a minute is affordability in today's market, because we talked about interest rates on the front end. Affordability very much driving the demand side of everything that we do. People going, if we're going to do something, now is the time. Now is the time that we need to get out there and do it because we can afford what we couldn't maybe a year or two ago. And so let me kind of break this down. We always use NAR's Housing Affordability Index. If you remember this, the index, the higher it is, the more affordable a home is. And where do we sit today? We sit at 168.2. The blue bar here in the Housing Affordability Index. We always reference the years when distressed properties dominated market as extreme affordability. You know, people think, well, homes aren't as affordable as they were 10 years ago. Well, there's an element of truth to that, absolutely. But let's not miss the fact that we're more affordable today than we were the last couple of years, the housing crisis, and way more affordable than 2008 and prior. That's something that I sometimes wonder if we take enough time to look at and go, wow, that's amazing. We remember when homes were real affordable 10 years ago in the housing crash, and I get that. But let's not forget the position we have in affordability as it relates to historically speaking. That's a big, big deal. The other piece of affordability, and this is, you know, is coming out, you know, we in a bubble and the homes are at all-time highs, all of those things, is the percentage of income needed for a mortgage payment is at a historical low. That historic number is 21.2%. And today that sits at 14.9%. That's the percentage of income somebody needs on average they've dedicated to their mortgage payment. Okay, so we don't see that number climbing. Yeah, if we saw that above 21.2%, I'd say, okay, look, that's above what, you know, historically we've looked at. No, we're below that in the commitment to a mortgage payment from an individual on average across the country. You know, the next piece of this is, you know, the typical mortgage payment for an individual as adjusted by inflation, and that today sits at $826. A better rate than any time here except for January 2012, which if you look at a map of the crisis, the bottom of the housing crash was around January, February of 2012, okay? And homes were extremely, extremely affordable then. And so that beats today. But today we're more affordable than 2018, 2019. Going all back to 2000, certainly more affordable than that. Very much more affordable than 2006. We saw prices rising in this country. And so I think being able to point this out, being able to show people this is going to be critically important. Let's also remember that there's a difference between housing affordability and affordable housing, okay? Two different things. And I know there's some areas where like, there's no affordable housing, and that's true, right? That's a different issue than overall housing affordability in this country. The next piece I think it's important as we talk about affordability we can't leave out is this. Once you include the equity benefit of price appreciation, owning made more financial sense than renting in 48 of the top 50 markets, with the only exceptions being San Francisco and San Jose, California. So if you took an average price point, and you can do this math wherever you want to do it, $300,000 house increases by 5% this year, that's $15,000 in equity in wealth for that individual, for that family. We can't overlook that in housing. You know, not only, 2020 redefined the meaning of home, but also the financial benefits that go along with that are critically important. You know, coming up, we have our 2021 spring buyer and seller guides. Those will be out the first week of March. So be on the lookout for that. A lot of this information put into a guide that I know so many of you use and will use as folks are transacting business over the spring market. So keep in mind, those are coming up and certainly want you to use those and want to remind you about those. Our team works diligently to prepare the best information and update those for you. I'll end on this, and I think it's something I want to encourage you with today. I want to give you a little perspective. It comes from Donald Miller. If any of you know Donald Miller, he wrote a book called Story Brand Marketing. He said, people do not follow the best leaders. They follow the ones they can understand the easiest. Think about that. They don't follow the best leaders. They follow the ones they can understand the easiest. So here's my challenge as we wrap up the monthly market report. Is in what you're doing, can folks understand you simply and effectively? Are you putting out information and educating people in a way where they go, you know what, I understand it? If there's ever been a time in the world where people needed a resource to understand what's going on, to make sense of everything they hear, it's right now. And I think that's our job in what we do across the country, is to make things simple and effective and make it easy where people can follow it. They don't have to go back with a slide, you know, try to understand everything. They can understand it pretty simply. So hope this finds you well. I look forward to these and being with you every month. We'll be back again next month. And thank you for the time you invest into listening to the Monthly Market Report. Take care.